I stand. I come with joy to meet my Lord, for King loved and free. Sing to the Lord, whose mercy is ever from everlasting to everlasting. How can we sing the Lord's song when so many are without? Sing to the Lord, whose faithfulness renews us every morning. But how can we sing the Lord's song when so many are gone? Sing to the Lord, who has not forgotten the melodies of salvation. Let us remember the joy of the Lord and sing a new song together. Join me in prayer. Almighty God, even as the drums of warfare beat on through the night, even as the cries of injustice linger in the morning, even as the hustle of busyness rumbles through the day, quiet our hearts, still our thoughts, join us in our worship. Remember us in your mercy as we try to remember you. Through the proclamation of your good news, in story and in song, and through the hospitality of your gracious table, welcome us again, one Lord, Creator, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Our first hymn this morning is Great is Thy Faithfulness from the Blue Hymnal, number 276.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Great indeed is the faithfulness of God, and yet our hearts are not so reliable. We wander, we argue, we forget, we divide ourselves with anger and bitterness and falsehood. Let's try to come back together again, and let's start with the truth. Let's confess our sins to God and also to each other. Join me in prayer. Almighty God, Mother of Mercy, Father of Grace, you have called us to one table, but we have pursued our own course. You have promised us the abundance of all creation, but in our greed and in our envy, the world goes without. You have promised us the bread of life itself, but in our pride and in our arrogance, the world goes hungry. You have promised us the waters of peace and justice, but in our violence and in our discord, the world goes thirsty. And now we are famished too, Lord. Have mercy on us, forgive us again, transform us at this table and for this table, and send us from this table as servants of your righteousness by the power of your Son, our Lord. Amen. Take a few moments now for your silent confession before God. Even when our cups run dry, God's grace overflows. Even when our plates are empty, God's generosity overflows. And even when our hearts feel barren, God's love overflows. Friends, you have been called and claimed by the God of all things, and by the abundance of God's grace, and by the power of God's love, your sins have been forgiven. Be in peace. Amen. Be seated. Hear this prayer. Almighty God, give us ears to hear your story in these words of Scripture. Give us eyes to see your story in the faces of those that surround us. And give us faith enough that by your grace we might serve you until the end of our days. Amen. I give you Reverend Doug Sivers.
From Psalm 8, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars, which you have set in place, What is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings that you care for them? You have made them little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You have made them rulers over the works of your hands. You have put everything under their feet, all flocks, all herds, and animals of the wild, the birds of the sky, and the fish of the sea that swim in the paths of the sea. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
What
Thank you, Martha and the choir, for reminding us that from this table, we are one, and we are led by the one God into service in his name. From the letter of Paul to the Hebrews, the first chapter. In the past, God spoke through our ancestors, to our ancestors through the prophets, at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, God has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. After he had provided purification for sin, he sat down at the right hand in the majesty of heaven. So he became as much superior to the angels as the name he has inherited is superior to theirs. It is not to angels that he has subjected the world to come, about which we are speaking. But there is a place someone has testified. What is mankind that you are mindful of them? A son of man that you care for him. You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned them with glory and honor and put everything under their feet. In putting everything under them, God left nothing that is not subjected to or is not subject to them. Yet at present, we do not see everything subject to them. But we do see Jesus, who was made lower than the angels while now crowned with glory and honor because he suffered death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. And bringing many sons and daughters to glory, it was fitting that God, through whom everything exists, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through what he suffered. But the one who makes people holy and those who are made holy are of the same family. So Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters. He says, "I will declare your name, my brothers and sisters, to the assembly. I will speak their praises." Let us hear God's word for this day. Amen. World Communion Sunday is a gift from the Presbyterian Church to the larger church at large. The first celebration of World Communion Sunday grew out of the dream and the hope of Dr. Hugh Thompson Kerr, who served as pastor at Shadyside Presbyterian Church in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. World Communion grew out of the division of stewardship at Shadyside Church. It was their attempt to bring churches together in a service of Christian unity, in which everyone might receive both inspiration and information, but most of all, to know how important the Church of Jesus Christ is, and how each congregation, how each person, how each of its parts is interconnected with one another to bring forth the ministry of Christ unto this earth. The foundations of this idea lie deeply embedded in the history of our tradition as Christian people. The words that give truth to this idea were written in the very first pages of what we call our Holy Bible. In Genesis 1, we read, God created humanity in God's image. In the divine image, God created them, male and female, God created them. God blessed them, and God said, be fertile and multiply, fill the earth and master it, take charge of the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and everything crawling on the ground. Then God said, I now give you all the plants of the earth that yield seeds, and all the trees that whose seeds produces its seeds within it. These will be your food. To all wildlife, to the birds of the sky, to everything crawling on the ground, to everything that breathes, I have given green grasses for food. And that is what happened. God saw everything God made, and it was supremely good. This first creation story in Genesis introduces us to a God who creates, who makes all things, and that all that God creates is good, even by that God who appears to be at a distance from us as we read those words. But when God sets out to create humankind, there's a change in the pace and the emphasis of the story. The story slows down. Three times the author affirms that God created humankind in God's image. And then the narrative changes from stately prose to verse. God affirms all of creation step by step in the process. But only humankind receives explicit blessing. This creation account presents a God whose greatness does not rule out intimacy. Here is a God of relationship, a God who ordains that we are part of what God is about and charges us with responsibility in the task. If we move forward in scripture to the hear the song of the psalmist, Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name throughout the earth. When I look at your skies that your fingers have made, the moon, the stars that you set firmly in place, maybe it was like the beautiful sky of last night, filled with stars and the wonder of God's creation. What are human beings as you think about them? What are human beings that you pay attention to them, he asked. You've made them only little less than the divine, crowning them with glory and grandeur. Psalm 8 embraces what it means for this God of greatness to invite us into relationship. The psalm begins by shouting out God's glory from the heavens on such a beautiful starry night under which he sat. The psalm marvels that God would take notice of human beings in all this wonder, and yet somehow God bestows upon them near divine status, little lower than God's own self. God has created an amazing, inclusive, integrated, relational world. The management and the operation of this world lies upon our shoulders. Every piece, every item, every person is valuable and necessary for the whole. If one piece, if one item, if one person is excluded from the whole, we all suffer the consequences because every piece, every item, every person is necessary to that whole. Sadly, I think this message, this understanding that every piece, every item, every person created for the whole has been lost. We don't operate on that scale. We get more focused on the task rather than the mission. We get lost in the minutiae of the arrangements and the colors and the schemes of things, and we jostle and tussle with each other, we argue with each other, and we throw our hands up in disgust and frustration. In our operation, a piece lost, an animal extinct, a fish's environment destroyed in economic environment and development. An item like the chestnut tree is lost due to disease. The ash trees gone now from our midst, destroyed by an infestation of insects. The Brazilian rainforest mowed over in economic growth and an ecology destroyed. A person missing from the pews, but life goes on. There's a hymn that we like to sing. We raise our voices loudly, and I think oftentimes too proudly in its singing. Its message, it's simple. Its lyrics say, we are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. We will work with each other. We will work side by side. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. And then I hear these words of Jesus. This is how everyone will know that you are my disciples, when you love each other. From John's Gospel. Not more rules, not more theological arguments, not more power, not more righteousness, not more clubs, more activities, more busyness. Love and caring for each other is our job. And the example of that love is Jesus Christ, the incarnation of God, made to humanity, through humanity, for humanity. He came to humanity to live among us, to teach, to express God's love in all that he did. This is our next step through the journey of Scripture. For as the author of Hebrews says, in the past, God spoke through our ancestors, through the prophets, and many times and in many various places. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he anointed heir of all things, and through whom he made the universe. Created by God, set in a marvelous world to husband, if you will, to care for, to protect, to enhance, to make all its parts with no exclusions from the foundation of Christ's love for the world. This is our job. We are to be cognizant of every part of God's creation, every piece, every item, every person in relationship to us and to all others, balancing and protecting, enhancing relationships so that every piece, every item, every person may thrive and may be fulfilled. God's ecology includes it all, and us all, taking in the various ways what is known and what is honored and what is praised for itself as a part of the whole. This is the way of Jesus. Jesus never excluded, never left others behind along the way, always opened the doors, making sure that we were all part of the whole without discrimination and loss. This is the table of Christ around which we are about now to gather. This before us is a table where there is always room. It is a table built on the economy of God through Jesus that is one of plenty when persons take priority. This is the economy of the church. It is abundant. It is always inclusive, or it is not Christ's church. We celebrate this with Christians around the world this morning. From the rising of the sun at the earliest hour as it moves across the meridian and eastward in this world of ours to open the daylight as it comes. From the rising to the setting of God's Son. God's Son. If we look around ourselves, or where we are and who we are, is there a neighbor who once sat next to us who is not here? Let's call them, invite them back, adjust the area in which we worship, or the way in which we worship, or the posture in which we worship, so they can feel accepted and included again. Is there a neighbor who needs a helping hand getting ready for winter? Go rake the leaves. Hold the door for that person who's walking behind you with a smile, and the smiles broaden on both our faces. Take time to listen to a friend or to visit someone who cannot get out or who needs a ride to go get a haircut because they don't have their own means of transportation or they need a welcoming hand to assist them. Love opportunities come in all shapes and ways and expressions. Let our life, let all our lives be the sermon that reflects Jesus' love for one another. You will find among your papers this morning a song sheet. On the front and the back are printed music. We would ask you to turn to that number 2137 piece of music and stand and join and sing together. I ask you to pray this song as we sing it. The question is probing, would I have answered when you call? Please stand and sing together. Let us remain standing and join with me, if you will, in the affirmation of faith. We believe in one holy, universal Christian church, the unity of the communion of saints of the entire human family. And we believe that this unity of the people of God must be manifest and active in that we love one another, that we give ourselves willingly and joyfully to one another, that we are to share one baptism together, that we eat of one bread and drink of one cup together, that we confess one name, one Lord, one cause, with one hope, which is the height and breadth and depth of the life of Christ. Forever and ever. Amen. Let us be seated. The devastation of the southeastern part of our nation has been in the news for the past several days. And this morning we are told that another hurricane follows in some of its same path. In the next weeks ahead, we're going to discover how devastating those floods have been. And we will be given opportunity to give financially to organizations and efforts to care for those people and those situations. I need, as a pastor, to say to you, first of all, be careful about how you give your money. Our churches are one of the best agencies and means by which we can get money into those areas that have need. Our churches are organized to do this. If we choose an organization, choose a reputable and faithfully administered organization. The Red Cross, the Samaritan's Purse are good options. Or if we know persons and families personally who live in those areas, we have family there, and many of us do, be in touch with them. Know to whom it is and to whom you are giving. Be careful and not base your decisions on emotions, and you will see a lot of that pulled on your heartstrings in the next month, days and months on our television screens. Make every effort to make the gifts you have legitimate and carrying your love and your concern for the people for whom we have been and will continue to be praying. Give generously, give wisely, and give often, because God's ecology is an ecology of abundance. The ushers will wait upon you for your gifts and your tithes.
Thank you. And you give expressions of concern and joy this morning as we worship God. And we want to give a mic for you this morning.
I've got several things to say today, and I had to even write them down. The first thing is thank you everyone who worked at the dinner last week and who attended, and those of you who didn't, you missed a darn good meal. Number two is one of our very faithful and oldest members of our church, Peg, is having a birthday this week, and a great shout out to Peg. Happy birthday. And this is for Joanne and Doug Sivers. I think Joanne's surgery is this week, the 14th, next week. Please be in prayer. She's having a knee surgery, and pray for Doug that he's a good nurse. And the fourth thing that I'd like to say is Ray and I are praising God for cardiology because Ray was really messed up. His pacemaker was all off, his meds were off, he was feeling faint all the time, his blood pressure was too low, and they finally got him straightened out this week and readjusted his pacemaker, and praise God, he is feeling much better. Thank you.
For Tuesday, where she will receive a kidney from her mother. So I'm just praying that everything will go well, and please continue to pray for both Kaylee and her mother that everything will go well on Tuesday. Thank you.
A couple of things that I'm thankful for. And a little concerned at the same time. Our son, Guy David, his wife, and son, Jonah, left yesterday for Italy to visit their son, Keith, who was in the Air Force. So I just have been, you know, praying for safe travels and also for them to enjoy their time there. It wasn't easy for them to be able to financially make this trip, so I hope they can get the best out of it. And also, this last week, I spent a wonderful evening with my granddaughter, Annalise, who graduated from Penn State in the spring, has an internship now at, the name of it, it's gone from me now. Anyway, it's a beautiful resort at Mount Washington, New Hampshire. And so this will be an adventure for her, but she's been preparing for it for 4 years. And so I hope that it's everything that she hoped it would be. So just be thinking of them this week. Thank you.
Give me the details here. Some of you, many of you may know Sandy White from Interfaith. Her son, Ethan, is a missionary in Lebanon, along with his wife. And they have been,
And three children?
Three little children, okay. And they've been notified that the city where they're in Lebanon, their missionaries there, is going to be bombed. And so they are trying to escape, and their plans are to be flying out of Baghdad at 10:20 tonight. That's around noon our time, and they will having to make their way to the airport that they're heading out of, which I understand is Baghdad Airport. So they're asking for prayers as they make this journey, and that they are safely able to get out of danger.
Good morning.
come before you reveling in your love and holiness, hearing your call to follow you with open hands and open hearts and open minds. As you speak to us, may we hear your living word, Jesus' clarion call to openness and understanding. Guide us individually and together into your way of wholeness and inclusivity in living and ministry together. Holy God, giver of peace, author of truth, we lay before you that we are divided and at odds with one another, with a bad spirit having risen among us. Take from us the mistrust, the party spirit, the contention, and all evil that now divides us. Work in us in a desire for reconciliation, so that putting aside personal grievances, we may go about your business with a single mind devoted to your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Gracious Lord, we have named before you many for whom you have regard and concern as well as us. Help us honor our prayers through committed living. Focus our intent. Direct our daily living and service. Raise our intentions to the level of your grace, that our efforts reflect you in all we do, that our prayers become action which improves lives and the being of others. And may our sacrifice of this worship be acceptable in your sight. Hear these words of invitation into our sacrament. This table is for all of us near and far, high and low, east and west, north and south. This table is for all of us, but it is not our table. It is not a Presbyterian table. It is not an American table. It is God's table for all of us. And it is a table of grace. So come and take your place at the table. You are welcome. You are invited. You are called. Come, let us share this meal together. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O Lord our God, creator and ruler of the universe. Even when we are dust, when our story begins in dust, you were there. Your word was there, your breath was there in the lifeless world. And upon your word, all creation sprang into life. When we were in the wilderness, terrified, timid, you were there. Your word was there, with manna, just enough for today, with water and even the driest rock, with the abundant grace upon which our story rests. And when we fell short, slaves to power and greed, you were there. Your word was there. The lips of prophets and the hearts of servants in stories of revolution and revelation and liberation, calling us even now to acts of courage and witness and peace. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with choirs of angels and prophets and apostles and martyrs and all the faithful of every time and place, who forever sing to the glory of your holy name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Indeed, blessed you are, O Christ, our Lord, for risking yourself among us, vulnerable and rejected, for teaching among us, teaching the radical hope of God, teaching grace to the world bent on vengeance, teaching love to a world bent on destruction, teaching peace to a world bent on tearing us itself apart. You were there, your word was there, even to the point of death itself. Even faced with terror and hatred and brokenness of the world, you rose again to new life, to new creation, to resurrection, that we might know something greater than the dust, that we might expect something greater than the end, that we might work for something other than ourselves. And as you speak again, with these abundant gifts of bread and wine, with which we joyfully celebrate your dying and rising, we await the table of the kingdom yet to come, as we dedicate ourselves again to you, thankful and transformed, as living and holy sacrifices, that our lives may proclaim the one crucified and risen. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us here, upon these gifts of bread and wine, that the bread we break together and the cup we share together may retell our common stories together and reshape our common bonds together and remember our common grace together in the community, in the body of and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, the one whose life and death you have torn down for, that has torn down our divisions. And so may we be one with all who share this feast. On this day, on all days, with your children at every corner of the table, may we share this abundant cup with all those who thirst for your justice. May we share this abundant bread with all those who hunger for your righteousness. May we be united in every corner of your story, united in hope and united in vision, united in purpose, united in ministry in every place. As this bread is Christ's body for us, send us from this table to be the body of Christ for the world. Send us with the spirit of courage, a spirit of power and love, that we may be witnesses to the creation of an unending story of your word, breathing life into the dust. Keep us faithful and fruitful and hopeful and peaceful until we come at last to the one table in your kingdom to feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm, with you and your word through Christ and in Christ, in one who came for us, died for us, rose for us, the one who prays even for us as the one who first taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, deliver us from evil. On the night when he was betrayed, Jesus broke bread with his disciples, and he said, Take, eat. This is my body given to you. Eat this in remembrance of me and be thankful. He then shared among them a common cup. Drink this, all of you, he said. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. And so we come to our table and we partake of this holy feast and we give ourselves as part of that whole into which one of us have been called, each one of us have been called to be part of that service and ministry across this world of which we're a part. You wait on me. The body of Christ given to you. Take and eat, feasting upon him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving. the blood of Christ. Take and drink in remembrance of our living Lord, and be thankful. Would you join me in the prayer following the sacrament? Gracious God, may we have received the sacraments, live in the unity of your Holy Spirit, that we may show forth your gifts of the world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Take that same song sheet from which we used earlier and turn it to the back side, and you will find the hymn, Whatever You Do. Please stand and sing joyfully this hymn together. May the God of creation and restoration give you confidence in the daily tasks that are set before you. The God of love and compassion assure you of your heritage as a child of God. The God of guidance and inspiration mold you in God's image. And the blessings of God, Creator, Redeemer, and sustainer, with you remain always and support you always. Amen.